contribute with an article on this journal, which I think is the world's oldest scientific journal. So, me, myself, Simon Cervenka, who cannot be here today, Pontus Lavén, Sigbrai, who is here today, as we can see, and Jacqueline Borg, who now is in Munich. We contributed with an article here, Brain Neuroreceptor Density and Personality Traits. Irina has a long interest in personality psychology. She's a professor at McMaster University in Hamilton, Ontario. And also a broader interest, I would say, in the biological underpinning of higher brain functions. And made several landmark contributions in the field. So we are very happy that you are here and look forward to your presentation.
Okay, wonderful. Thank you, Lars, for a very nice introduction and kind invitation to share our research. And I strongly believe that this place, Karolinska, is a leading lab or leading center for studying the impact of neurochemical systems on personality traits or individual differences. So the big plan for the talk would be I slightly touch the issue about challenges, why the taxonomy is not solved yet. Then we'll propose the framework. I will try to explain how come we came to this very structure and this very associations, and we'll show some examples of differential sensitivity of our model. And that's basically the criteria if the model is good or bad, that the model can differentiate between specific individual differences. So psychological diversity, this is a topic of my research for like maybe 30 years. I'm playing with taxonomies and trying to find biomarkers for that. And we all know that people can face the same adversity, but consistently they come with different coping styles. Even in psychiatry, we have patients with the same symptoms, the same severity, we give them the same dosage of the same medication, and we get different responses. So, question is, how about if we make a list of possible responses, maybe link it to specific biomarkers, and then maybe we can have our psychotherapy or pharmacological therapy more efficient, and at least we'll know more how to deal with the psychological diversity. Well, that's a good idea. And of course, right now it's about 40 plus models of the list of traits. And these models describe about 200 traits actually, but the dimensionality really varies between 2 and 21 dimensions. So it's a little bit jungle there. And our approach is going from differential psychophysiology. So this is a discipline that looks at biomarkers of individual differences that are based on biological factors. And I mind you, we need to be careful how do we talk about psychological individual differences. Some of them are very consistent, but some of them are not based on biological factors, such as system of values or beliefs. They might be consistent, but it's nothing to do with biology. So anyway, when we look at how we can list the temperament traits or biologically based individual differences, we face the complexity that all these systems, all these biomarkers that we can use for making our taxonomies, they're strongly, strongly interlinked and entangled. They regulate each other. And that's why we can't use dimensionality approach. Yes, I like mathematical models. I did play with it and still playing with that. And of course, factor analysis. But when we describe the structure of our individual differences, we have to respect that the so-called biomarkers that we're describing, they are not independent. So we have to forget independence. Now, we can imagine that we can line up this list of biomarkers that we identified to be individually consistent, and we can make the list. And that's what basically the whole fight is for. The fight between our model and Big Five, the fight between Big Five and Big Six and Big Seven, who comes with a better list. So whoever comes with a better list have more predictive power, all right? So that's what differential psychology, differential psychology, psychiatry, differential psychophysiology, it's all about, to differentiate between traits, right? But it's tricky because they're interconnected. And we feel that it really works to unify taxonomies of mental disorders and taxonomies in healthy people called temperament, because we can present the systems on the scale of degree of imbalance or degree of dysfunction in the systems. And temperament stays on the healthy pole of the disbalance, and mental illness stays on the strong disbalances pole. And of course, we do have an overlap, this gray area, where we can't tell for sure is it temperament or mental illness. And in fact, if you look at the structure of our DSM-4, DSM-5, it's almost anecdotal that this structure resembles the structure of four temperament types described by ancient doctors, Hippocrates and Galen, who first proposed that there's something chemical about individual differences and it relates to imbalances. So really, we could see, let's say, impulsivity and aggressive features in choleric temperaments and so on. Speaking about temperament, I really want you to get the sense of difference between temperament and personality. Because in American psychology, there is a big allergy, or let's say, you know, immunity to anything that Europeans did before America existed. And they think that concept of temperament outdated, and we just need to use one concept of personality for all individual differences. And me, being from Europe, of course, and being from a tradition of experimental studies of temperament traits, we rather keep this temperament concept alive. And that's our reasons, basically. Temperament relates by default, by definition, how Hippocrates defined it, relates to chemical basis of individual differences. Personality includes social cultural factors. Personality includes beliefs and values and attitudes and personal history, national identity, gender identity, etc., etc. So personality is more blended with socio-cultural factors, whereas temperament relates to specifically to biological, even more specifically to neurochemical systems. Temperament was found in animals. All temperament traits that you see in this printout, the slides, all of 12 of them, they were found in animals. And when we talk about animals, we don't talk about their personality. And yet, there is a huge area of studying temperament in animals in breeding sciences. They talk about temperament as a part of the descriptors of the specific subspecies. And of course, temperament is independent on culture, and it's consistent in a lifetime. So if nothing especially harmful, neurochemically speaking, happens to an individual, his or her temperament stay consistent in relation to the peers across a lifetime, taking into consideration age changes. Whereas personality can change over day. If something really terrible happens, person can change their beliefs, person can change their religiosity, person can change their national identity, whatever, right? So personality is more prone for changes than temperament. And early expression, of course, temperament can be identified right from the start of the infants, whereas personality takes a couple of years to build up. Most common argument against our approach is that, no, we need to blend temperament and personality concepts in one, under one roof of personality because of the interaction between social and biological factors, right? The most common argument is that there is nothing kind of free of social influences. And if there is nothing free of social influences, therefore, we should forget temperament and should keep the concept of personality, okay? Our argument is that, well, hello. There are other characteristics which are, again, biologically based, but they are interacting with socio-cultural factors, such as age, sex, and mental illness. All of them clearly found to be interacting with socio-cultural factors. They do affect our behavior. However, we don't blend them with the concept of personality, right? We keep them separately. And in fact, keeping them separately help us to study an interaction between biological factors and socio-cultural factors. So if we keep temperament, again, separated from the concept of personality, it would help us to separate the impact of neurochemical factors in the regulation of human behavior from socio-cultural factors. So just for a scientific reason of keeping the concepts clean and more precise, it makes sense to not blend it with personality. Okay? We are coming back to the idea that when we are developing our taxonomies of individual differences, we need to make it joint taxonomy of mental illnesses and temperament. And this idea is quite old, right from the start of psychiatry and professional psychology. A lot of authors proposed taxonomies including some mental illness features in their descriptors. So there are a lot of models and we need to pick the best one. There are two approaches, right? One going from experiments to the opinions, another is from opinions to experiments. So we belong to the first approach when people study neurophysiological kind of biomarkers of individual differences and then come up with a list. Alternative approach is the example of our known DSM, ICD, classifications of mental disorders, five-factor model of personality, Thomas and Chess temperament model, Watson and Clark, positive and negative affect model, etc. Right? So all these models that you hear more than about us. This approach is very difficult. That's what you do. It's very difficult. It's messy. And this approach is very much, much easier. Right? So this approach derives the models from the list of common descriptors or human judgments, human opinions about individual differences without looking at biology first. And that's what I want to mention, the weaknesses of, the, of for example, five-factor lexical approach models. The lexical approach starts from the long list of verbal descriptors. And if they use verbal descriptors as a source of data, they have to acknowledge a sociability bias of language. Language was created to bring people together, right? And as a result, language has much more words related to socialization or social interactions than words related to something else, okay? As a result, if you test this model, or let's say collect the descriptors in every single culture, you will get a huge factor of extraversion. So factor of extraversion is just an artifact of sociability bias of language. It has nothing to do with biological structure of individual differences. The same thing happens with factor of neuroticism. There is a well-documented negativity bias in emotionality. Even in language, we have more descriptors for negative emotions than for positive emotions. Again, coming with the same thing, we have the largest factor of interconnected items because they're similar, creating the factor of neuroticism. But if you look neurophysiologically, you have very well identified neurophysiological system of positive emotionality or positive moods, etc., which is mu-opioid receptor system, right? And it doesn't show up because language doesn't have enough descriptors for that, right? So lexical approach models are just slaves of their own methodology. And it's good to use it for studying social perception, and that's what Big Five originally was, just a study of social perception. But five-factor model of personality by McCrae and Costa, it's slightly different. They just took Big Five structure, and they announced it to be universal structure of individual differences. Another weakness of this opinion and then experiment model is that they often use factor analysis. And there are several flaws of factor analysis. The one that was criticized right from the scratch and they still didn't fix it, it's linearity, right? So they use matrices of linear correlations and then they start playing with that. And even in so-called nonlinear factor analysis, they still start with matrices of linear correlations and then have additional hierarchic and nonlinear structures. Meanwhile, every single phenomenon in psychology and psychiatry is nonlinear. Like literally, guys, there is not one single process that has a linear structure. And it was kind of well documented. Here are the examples of very simple nonlinearity, it's bifurcation. And I just want to kind of give you the idea what is missing if we make it just a kind of linear correlation. In bifurcation diagram, once you start increasing the value on one parameter, you have differential response on the other parameter. And that's how our psychological processes become contextual, right? We respond depends on different contexts. So nonlinear models usually are very powerful this way. They give you at least opportunity to play with the context, right? Linear models don't. They do too much approximation. Sometimes they come with the wrong conclusions. And in fact, a lot of my colleagues think, but linear is a good approximation, it's good enough. It's not actually, it can be missing a lot of things. Every single model has an energetic dimension in differential psychology or psychiatry. And even if you take the so-called arousal dimension or energetic dimension, okay, remember what's that? It's Jerks-Dodson law, right? It already exists more than 100 years, we know it very well. It has a curvilinear relationship. Now, let's pretend that we are doing linear correlation of some kind of linear function and this A function. We'll get insignificant correlation because in this way the curve goes up, in this way curves go down, whereas linear function goes up and up and up and up and up. Correlation will be very insignificant. So, oops, it will not create any factor. You will miss it completely. But we are talking about main dimension. Right? So linear models are not very powerful if we want to work on taxonomy. Let's use linear models for anything else, but not for taxonomy. Taxonomy requires conceptual thinking a little bit. And funny part that even more than 100 years ago, a model of taxonomy was proposed by Pavlov when he studied temperament in animals, and then his graduate students started using adults and children. He proposed something that we can call double bifurcation, when he said that the traits are kind of bifurcate once you start increasing the parameter along one scale. And another flaw of factor analysis is orthogonality. It just by default, it's looking for orthogonal or independent dimensions. So all scales should be independent. And they're very confused about the difference between psychometrics and deriving the taxonomy. Psychometrics is to check the properties of the test. But sometimes psychometrists dictate what's happening in differential psychology and development of taxonomies, and it's wrong. It's the same way that technicians who are serving telescopes would tell theoretical physicists something, how they should design the theory of the universe, right? It's wrong. So orthogonality or independence of dimension shouldn't be a requirement when we do the taxonomies. Why? Because in our biological systems, everything is interconnected. Everything is contingent and has strong feedback relationships. And feedback relationships were known for minimum 120 years when they started identifying feedback relationships in neuronal firing. And once more, examples of inefficient models, differential power. Remember, we said the models should differentiate well. Okay, the leading model now what? Negative and positive effect. These guys are sitting very well in top community who designed this Ardo community and designed the modern DSM-5 or five-factor model of personality. Okay, so they have two dimensions, which basically the core of their model, and several mental illnesses were studied in terms of these dimensions. Other factors in the five-factor model of personality were not so informative, so let's not talk about it, but mostly about these factors. Okay. In study of generalized anxiety disorder, they received a pattern that it's associated with high neuroticism and low extroversion or positive effect. Okay. So people who are anxious, they are kind of neurotic by some reasons, and don't want to socialize. Funny part is when they go to practically every single mental illness, it's the same pattern. Yes, patients feel kind of anxious that they're not doing well, and they don't want to socialize, like major depression disorder. And Watson, looking at this results, saying, oh yeah, we have to unify generalized anxiety disorder and major depression disorder in one single dimension of factor of distress disorders. And that thing, I think they just crossed the line. So anybody, like I'm a practicing clinical psychologist as well, anybody who is in practice of psychiatry and psychology just can't accept it. It's completely different nature. It's really completely different treatment. Everything is different. Of course, there are comorbid situations, but we are talking about it later. So we go with the first approach, and as I say, we use a couple of criteria for verifying that this model actually working. It should be based on neuroscience, it should be noted in animals, all traits, should be individually consistent and should differentiate well between mental disorders. Okay, neuroscience now. When we look at the ancient theory of temperament, we have to really appreciate the insight that temperament is based on the balance in chemical systems. And why it's important now to say it? Because guess what? He was the first, or among the first, to propose that it's a brain structures, or let's say brain, is the core of our psychological regulation. At that time, Egypt science was very strong, and the Egyptians believed that our behavior is controlled, our emotions, our reasoning, etc., is controlled by heart. And they considered brain like a thermostat. So he went against the crowd just to say that, nah, the regulation is probably in the brain and all this sort of soup that they hid, because they opened the brain and they see kind of soup there and they don't understand what the soup is about. But he said, no, it's probably something with the brain regulating it. And this means that for him, it wouldn't take much stretch to say that individual differences are coming from the brain structures. And that's basically what our MRI approach is, right? Let's do the MRI, see where it's located, what, and we're going. And yet, when he said, okay, in general, our behavior is regulated by neuroanatomy. However, when it comes to individual differences, this is probably about chemical imbalances, right? So he kind of almost contradicting himself, but he was brave enough to even reason along these lines. So when we are combining our notes from temperament research and psychiatry and clinical psychology, we probably should invite neurochemistry and psychopharmacology around the table and probably work on the model that stems from all those disciplines together. And in fact, when we think, how do we treat our mentally ill people? How do we actually adjust individual differences in behavior? We are doing it chemical ways. So chemistry is totally should be in the front of our models. Okay, that's good. So what do? We go to neurochemistry. We see the biomarkers. We look at the traits. We start correlating what works with what. And then we come with a model. Model, neurochemically verified, individual differences. Great plan. Except, as you know, we have several groups and families of neurotransmitters, and each of these families have several types. Each of these neurotransmitters, for example, monoamine transmitter has multiple functions, so potentially multiple traits. And within each of the monoamine neurotransmitters, we have multiple types of receptors, and each of them have different functionality. Plus, the functionality is different depending on the location in the brain. Is it striatum or frontal lobe, or sorry, prefrontal cortex or something like this, right? So, kind of jungle. And if it's not bad enough, they are really regulating each other. So they're all interconnected. So our first insight that let's pick up biomarkers and start linking it probably would be not fruitful. And that's why it takes so long from the moment when Hippocrates wrote it down and became famous with his theory of temperamentum. Temperamentum means mixture, right? Chemical mixture. To now, for 2,500 years, we are still not there yet because the matter is complex. As Lars mentioned, this year we invited several parties to start, let's say, exchanging the notes on neurochemistry and taxonomies. And we made this issue of philosophical transactions of the Royal Society. However, this complexity, it can't be done by one science. Not by neurochemistry, not by differential psychology, not by psychiatry, but by many, many disciplines sitting around the table. And I didn't include immunology. I didn't include endocrinology. And it should be here. Only with multidisciplinary approach we actually can get something out. But it's very hard when in our conferences we are very specialized. So meetings like this, and we want to make the sequel with a meeting. So if anybody wants to really participate, just really talk to us. Because Royal Society can support the meeting first and then the sequel of the journal. And it's a good crowd, actually. It's a burst to participate. Now to our baby. This is a baby, right? This is the result of my 30 years of digging into this. And it's a very busy slide. As I said, I printed it out. Because it's a busy slide, I'm going to go slow from here. A big part of the rest of my talk will be explanation, how did we get to this. Important part just to note is that we suggest that there is no one-to-one correspondence between one neurochemical system and one trait. The systems work in ensemble, but they work in ensemble not with everything with everything. There is a logic association in terms of functional aspects of construction of behavior, and this logic association allows us to separate kind of functionality based on, for example, linear neurotransmitter, monoamine neurotransmitters, or functionality of the groups of neurotransmitters. Let's start from the beginning, how we split it. First split on two parts. It was suggested by Kant a couple of hundreds of years ago. He actually spelled it out in his book, mapping four Hippocrates types into two dimensions. So he suggested that if we separate dimensions related to energy or activity and emotionality, we will get four temperament types. Independently from him, probably, and using different wordings, similar two dimensions were proposed by Wundt, Heymans, Pavlov, Kretschmer, Adler, Ising, and Gray, of course. So, before Big Five came to power with their first two leading factors, these two dimensions were a pretty much consensus in anybody who was thinking about structure of individual differences. And they basically could describe four types of individual differences. In our model, it's all the top nine traits and bottom red traits, right? Now, after that, consensus stops. After that, it's a zoo, okay? After that, people come with different kind of methods and lists, etc. And if you look at the neurochemistry, as I say, it's a lot of complexity. So if you want to move forward, we need to just step back, actually, and look at why do we have this diversity? Why do we have this complexity of systems regulating our behavior? An amoeba, one-cell organism, can do approach withdrawal. And a lot of temperament models, actually, like Gray, for example, sometimes models they call it approach withdrawal, came with this just two dimensions, approach withdrawal, describing the diversity of temperaments. Amoeba can do fine without additional neurotransmitters. Why do we need all this complexity? And of course, evolutionary psychologists will tell us, because of the human behavior, because it's whatever humans or animals were doing in their life, adjusting to the environment, which is true, okay. So how about if you look at what animals were doing, or structure, universal structure of construction of behavior. And it should be really universal. So it shouldn't relate to personal experience or memory, and it should be universal across situations, right? In this case, it works to look at universal architecture of action construction, and the best science for it is kinesiology or functional neurophysiology. People who actually looked at how humans are regulating their behavior in any situation, what's common between that. And for that, we need to look at least I'm going to give you examples from three independent disciplines, but I only mentioned pioneers. Like Hippocrates was a pioneer, I mentioned him. These guys are pioneers. For ethical reasons, they were first, they didn't know where to go, so it's really important to mention them. Anyway, Anohin, what did he do? He rewired kids' afferent and efferent nerves, basically flipped the location, and flexors and extensions muscles. Kid received completely different body and had to relearn how to build the behavior, construct the behavior from scratch. Anohin proposed the model of blocks, or let's say aspects of functional activities that helps animal to construct the action. Number two science is a kinesiology, again, pioneer who came up with his own devices. It's his original devices in the 30s. And now the whole science of kinesiology basically reproduce similar things like tracking device and registering physiology device. How people are learning action and how the people perform already well-learned action. He came up with a quite extensive theory of action construction. It has a lot of useful insights. I really highly recommend you to read mostly recent work in English on this, but it's kind of famous, you know, level of constructions and algorithms of constructions, etc. He came with a model. And number three discipline is clinical neuropsychology, and that's where I came from. He's my like academic grandfather, because my graduate supervisor was his graduate student. As you know, Luria was famous for inventing neuropsychological assessment batteries, and he had access to huge sample of brain injured patients from Second World War. When he was reasoning about separation between my biomarkers, let's say how we can classify the systems regulating of behavior, he again identified three blocks. Okay? Now, these are the models. This is the model of Anohin, this model of kinesiology, Bernstein, this is the model of clinical neurophysiology. They're all different, they all have different components, they have different complexity, different names. However, they converge on understanding that, at least on a very, very rough level, we should keep separate descriptors for aspects orienting behavior, expanding the degrees of freedom in behavior, aspects what they called programming, they just love the word programming, or putting the priorities on, that limiting the degrees of freedom, saying, okay, this go first, other things go next, okay? And systems that maintaining the behavior, basically, looping it, just keep it running. Now, I just want you to appreciate that this is sort of kybernetic model, and relationships between blocks can be really seen in clinical practice or in individual differences. When people can't put together a program, can't select, they keep expanding their degrees of freedom. And people who can't expand their degrees of freedom, he said, okay, just go. Let's choose first whatever capacity, just go, okay? Then if they made a program, they can just keep looping and doing it. Or some people, when they can't do something, they stop and they start choosing other alternatives. Of course, some people are not capable of doing it, reprogramming, so they just keep doing whatever they know how to do, even if it's not adaptive, right? But you can see that even from here, you can speculate about several types of individual differences when you look how the systems relate to each other. Again, they're entangled, but at least we can have some sort of sorting, functional sorting between them. Of course, more modern scientists came with their taxonomies or descriptors of regulatory systems, but it's funny that consistently we did have these three blocks on the market. I'm just going after consensus. Now let's go to neurochemistry. So here the abbreviations I'm going to use, of course. This model was done before I started working with Trevor, but when we were preparing the paper with him, he helped me to realize some imperfections with one of the traits in this model. So one of the traits is his acetylcholine trait. So we published a paper with him as well, describing this model. Briefly, about consensus between neurochemistry and previous three sciences. And that's what's interesting, that we can see some resemblance even in neurochemical studies. Let's forget about specificity of receptors for now, and look at general functionality of monoamine systems. I love these studies because it's, of course, cats. Who cares about rats nowadays? Cats mostly. Cats were exposed to all kind of pleasures, and they registered the neuronal firing in different type of neurons, noradrenaline and serotonin. And what they found that when cats are exposed to this, noradrenaline neurons behaved very differently. They were doubling and tripling the activity, whereas serotonin neuron didn't change whatsoever in response to the stimuli. However, when the novel stimuli were repeated, then response of noradrenaline neurons started changing. They started having less and less firing. So dog was barking, pain continued, heat was continuing, everything else was kind of repeating. But neurons, in ordinary neurons, stopped their kind of orientational things. And whereas serotonin neurons just firing and firing, everything nice, firing and firing, right? So that was done, 30 years ago? And of course, much more studies were done in terms of functionality of noradrenaline. And so far, I don't think any objections that noradrenaline is involved in kind of expansion of degrees of freedom in orientation to novelty, specifically to novelty, attention to novel stimuli. And of course, when we are talking about participation of noradrenaline systems in regulation of HPA axis, arousal and stress response, it's all about expansion of degrees of freedom, of course, right? Now, dopamine is a completely different story, right? And I read a couple of your papers, guys, as well. There was a lot of buzz about the role of dopamine in extraversion, right? And of course, it's still old tale going on, including Wikipedia, that dopamine is a happy monoamine. It makes us motivated and happy and positive moods, etc., right? However, studies showed that, for example, appetitive stimuli, which is nice motivative factors, they evoke less degree of activity in dopamine neurons than adverse stimuli. And dopamine release was noted in negative stimuli as well. So more and more lately, I read opinions that dopamine is likely a system regulating assignment of salience to stimuli, whether positive or negative valence, it doesn't matter. It's a salience, it's importance of stimuli. And if it's indeed true, then it explains why dopamine is a key neurotransmitter in controlling plasticity. Because plasticity is about reprogramming of behavior, and reprogramming is about prioritizing choices, right? What I should do now, what I should do next, let's change the priority. And dopamine, GABA, glutamate networks and striatum and cortex kind of quite noted for regulation of plastic behavior. Or of course, when they're compromised, behavior become more impulsive and rigid, right? Now, what about the theory of extraversion? Well, in theory, if it would be true that dopamine is a happy neurotransmitter, increase in dopamine should lead to better mood. And we all know that excess of dopamine doesn't lead to better mood. It leads to schizophrenia, right, and psychosis. Why? Maybe because the theories who think that dopamine is about salience and importance or significance of event, maybe the theories are true. Because if you ever dealt with schizophrenic patients, the problem is they attribute too much significance to stimuli. Their perception is very sticky. Everything is important for them. And of course, increase of dopamine in schizophrenic patients doesn't make them happy. They're very unhappy. They're constantly depressed, and some of them suicidal, and some of them actually commit suicide. So I don't think dopamine makes people happy. However, what we see partially true is, of course, if dopamine assigned salience or significance to stimuli, and when we put the program together, dopamine is essential to highlight a positive way to go, and that's why it's a very crucial neurotransmitter system in making our programs and making our goal-directed behavior. Okay, we divided the dimension of activity into three parts, and next division happened when we realized that routine or well-learned elements of behavior and probabilistic or uncertain or complex or novel aspects of behavior are regulated by different systems. And of course, now it's well documented in terms of neuroanatomy, and we just published a paper with Robin's neurochemical level, that even in our monoamine systems, we have branches in neocortex are implicated in regulation of probabilistic aspects of behavior, when behavior should constantly readjust to changing situations or uncertain situations, and more or less well-learned aspects of behavior. And I remember Robbins and others actually published several papers on transition of the control over the construction of behavior from prefrontal cortex to ventral striatum to dorsal striatum once we start learning in more and more and more behavioral items. But if the situation becomes unpredictable, the control gets back to frontal cortex. And the next split happened when people realized that social verbal aspects of behavior is regulated by different systems, even neuroanatomically, than physical and mental aspects of behavior, or probabilistic aspects of behavior. And this so-called activity-specific approach, separating mental, physical, and social verbal aspects, was offered in the school that I graduated from. And they used a number of electrophysiological measures, but they didn't study neurochemistry. However, when we go to neurochemistry, now we hear more and more about role of oxytocin and sometimes vasopressin in social affiliative aspects of behavior, really kind of distinct functionality. Whereas physical aspects of behavior already were well documented related to like growth hormone or somatostatin regulation of behavior. And of course, this is used in Olympic Games screening of the athletes. So this is like well documented knowledge. Okay, now we are to the last split, and this is the most interesting one because it's more common to attribute emotional aspects of behavior to action of monoamines. And that's not what I suggest. It seems like it's probably opioid receptor systems that create dispositions to act emotionally in a certain way. Emotional dispositions. It's not emotional reactivity, but when nothing is happening, people already have constantly like either anxious mood or dysphoric mood or whatever. And this is all about density or regulation in opioid receptor system. And when we think about how the release is happening of our beloved monoamines, it's opioid receptor systems who are G-protein coupled receptor systems. So they actually control the release of monoamines because most of synapses employed in monoaminergic systems are G-protein coupled receptor system, right? They're not classic ligand receptors. G-protein coupled receptor systems, they have this extra input from the, let's say, state of the body because they work with proteins, and proteins in turn they work with other systems, so it's a lot of kind of contingency there. They basically regulate the release of monoamines. And there is a very logical pattern into it. So dysregulation in kappa opioid receptor system was linked to chronic anxiety. And guess what? This is the way. This is the increase, right? So it has a release of noradrenaline. So this is red, right? Noradrenaline. So it increases the release of noradrenaline, but suppresses the release of dopamine. And mu opioid receptor system works in opposite way. Delta kind of almost copying the mu opioid receptor system directionality, but with some variations. So when we put it together, at least one level, imagine there are two levels of this, cortical level and let's say striatum level. But if you put just on one level, just one family of interactions, we are not mentioning other families, how everything is interacting, just to spell out this interaction, we see that our functional relationships, remember, I stopped on three blocks, how they interact. We can see that traits can be a derivative of a regulation, so let's say slight imbalances of the regulation between these couples or trios sometimes. I just didn't put neuropeptides here. But it makes sense then. Then we can describe our traits as sort of functional types of behavior, how people construct the behavior in a certain way. And we can even do more, we can actually structure the context with the same 12 components, and then we can probably have more predictable models than just models deriving from only individual differences. But as I say, dysregulation of these strategies can be described as a type of trait. So here is the model, and again, here is a list of the scales that our test is using. And in fact, the test was proposed 30 years ago by my supervisor. Then 10 years ago, we proposed another model, which is more in line with Luria structuring, because he came after Anohin structuring, I came after Luria structuring. So let's say his model was 4x3, my model is 3x4. The details is kind of probably not necessary now, but it's a lot of resemblance to the scales that he proposed. And we borrowed his validity history because it's partially his questionnaire. We only added up 5 more scales. And therefore, we suggest that this test is well validated. Now, let's look at the convergence between models of temperament or personality. They call it personality, we call it temperament, no problems. So if you have a favorite model, it's there. Now, of course, I go to Karolinska, I have to look what Swedish group does. Before it was a Karolinska here, but now I see you guys using different scales.
Instead of 140 items, it was reduced to
52. Right. Yeah, and I think they really didn't do improvement. I'm sorry. Yeah.
The original.
Yeah, original. Because, see, in original, you actually had here the scale of psychasthenia, which is kind of a reverse scale of physical endurance. And it's an important scale if you want to classify depression. And by some reason, they took it, very important scale, like really crucial scale. It's not in this Swedish.
No, SPC. It's been removed. But I do think that the reliability and factor structure of the remaining scale
right.
is improved in this update.
Yeah, but see, they're always going after the logic of factor structure, or factor analysis, and the wrong logics. They shouldn't rely on psychometrists to tell them how they have to structure. It's really, psychometrists should be the last people to listen.
I think we've been influenced.
Exactly, totally.
American
not only you, approach. Not only you, not only you, yeah, all Europe. So here I have only one resemblance with one scale. In social scales, just look at this. Detachment versus social desirability. It's probably along one continuum, maybe. But I wouldn't call it social desirability empathy because it's mixed up with sensitivity to social expectations. Here, again, it's a mixed up scale. We would call this social verbal tempo because it was actually documented and linked to specific temporal areas. Here, I think this is like very mixed scale, but it's related to speed of verbal production and, of course, to impulsivity and low satisfaction.
Yeah, an important comment that everybody here knows about this scale, but actually it was developed in this house.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah, Daisy Charlene was the first professor of psychology at the Karolinska Institute.
Yeah, okay. But as I say, the common way for psychologists to do it, it's not to go to experiments with all these biomarkers and kill me now kind of. No, it's going to, okay, such an important concept is used in psychiatry and it's very important characteristics. How come we don't have the scale? Let's have the scale. So it's very opinion based, right? And that's where the opening the door for troubles, right? A Swedish SP, Karolinska. Don't have any frontal scales, like it's practically intelligence here, plasticity, or let's say sustained attention. But for emotionality scales, I have two slides. You have like a lot of things on emotionality scales in this Swedish SP form, and even in Karolinska personality tests, it was a lot of emotionality related scales. So here, on this mu opioid receptor system, it's a lot of scales that can be related to it, but in a various perspective. Because satisfaction, that's what mu opioid receptor activation does. It's a sense of satisfaction. If you have low satisfaction, you have chronic dysphoria, irritability. You really have mistrust, and there are some results showing that feeling of security is really linked to mu opioid receptors. And embitterment, it's again the same dysphoria. So anyway, this is completely different scales in the current test. Impulsiveness, yes, and then I would suggest unifying this anxiety things because we are talking about dispositional emotionality, and dispositional is always partially somatic, partially psychological. Now, we have this pack, not accommodated, kind of forefront scales. I suggest that it's a combination of several of them, and why do I suggest? Because partially I'm a cognitive psychologist as well. I spent like 10, 15 years studying psychosemantics, and I'm still kind of toying with this. This is one of the studies related to temperament differences in attitudes, in perception. It was nice size samples, so we managed to have contrast groups, and that's what I suggest you guys do. If you have a test like this, collect the sample and separate them by contrasting values along the scales, and just see that how people are with low motor endurance versus high motor endurance differ, and so on. With other scales are different, right? So that's what we did. We used a very well thought experimental paradigm that is coming back to Charles Osgood actually. And we used very, very neutral nouns, very neutral adjectives, just to say that if there are any significant differences between contrast groups related to the semantic perception. So what we received, we received that people with high motor endurance, physical endurance, right, physical capacities, that is the number of significant differences up from the 60 scales. So 25 or 20 scales out of 60 showed the significant difference. It's a lot of differences, actually, right? And these measurements are adjusted for Bonferroni correction, so for repetitive measure. It's already filtered. It's already highly significant. And you can see the pattern that people with motor endurance tend to give more positive evaluations to absolutely neutral, completely blind, completely like really dummy nouns and adjectives. And so social endurance people, right? So that's what basically effect of what they called extroverts, happy about everything. Yeah, the study too was consistent, it's just a small sample. However, emotionality people, highly emotional people, it was just reverse sort of stuff. They were projecting negative evaluations on very innocent abstract nouns, etc. So they had more negative evaluations here. Now, coming back to our question, how we can do your orphan scales. If you look at the stress susceptibility, or if you look lack of assertiveness, so stress susceptibility is usually associated with stronger sort of physical capacities. I know, it's maybe speculation. So maybe it's higher motor endurance, so let's say low sarcopenia, if you look at old Karolinska scale, and more sense of satisfaction with life. And lack of assertiveness, it might be a reverse pattern. When you have poor satisfaction and feel weak to go and break the walls and knock the doors or whatever it is. Physical aggression, as I said, it's probably a compositional trait. And my colleagues so far, they describe several aggressions and they say several types of psychopathic behavior. So I wouldn't call aggression as something linked to very, very specific neuroanatomic or neurochemical system. Of course, we have a test, 12 scales, 77 items, takes only 10 minutes or 15 minutes to complete it. And that's the difference between the models. That's the old model. This is our current model. Why it's important for me to compare it? Because we had common validation history. 7 out of the scales were validated before I rearranged the items. So it's very important to really include the validation history. But when I rearranged the items, we did additional validation for the new 5 scales. And it's done already, you have it in the middle. And this is just a reference for validation test, okay? It's a reference to whoever validated it. That's how test looks like in PDF and in Excel file. It's free for use, it's on the internet in 15 languages. Once a person completed it, in Excel file, you can just click in summary and you already see the profile. And it's very useful if you deal with clinical samples and you need to please and butter or motivate your subject to do that extra 10 minutes. So you can say, I can show you your profile right away. So you go on the next page, you print page one out of one. You just be careful that you print only one page. Otherwise, Excel will print like 250 pages. So anyway, so yeah, you just print one page and everything is there, the name of the patient, sex, blah, blah. And if you just scroll a little bit down, it has a description of the scales. So you can see the profile right away. Now we have, of course, Swedish version for that. So it's right here somewhere. And about differential power, sensitivity. When we did studies on sex differences, we received the pattern very much in line with a pattern reported in the literature. And that's how you can see importance separating between really social aspects of behavior, mental and physical. Because this way you saw the really difference between men and women. But if your personality tests don't separate between physical and social, you will not see the main thing why women and men are different. Age differences, again, really makes sense to separate such traits like sensation seeking or motor tempo, etc. I don't know any model except our model, two models, my graduate supervisor and mine, that include traits related to tempo or let's say speed of integration. And yet, if you study age differences, speed of integration like motor tempo and social tempo and plasticity are the key of changes related to aging. So it kind of needed. And of course, sensation seeking is an important part. So let's do diagnosis now. Because the idea is if a temperament model is structured well, then when we have a mental illness, if we really structured it well, in mental illness, this whole thing should highlight very well.
And if you see any references, meaning there are studies about these patterns, but of course a lot of studies should be done, and we are not saying that we have the final result. But so far, I'm just going to page down, and you will see how different the patterns are. Just visually look at this, how different the patterns are if you go through the diagnosis. And that's basically the summary. If we put all together all the diagnoses in one sheet, that's how they look like. But it's much more portable system of individual differences or even mental disorders if you work with this way. And just if you're curious, we have several studies on depression, and the results are here. Again, we can just do analogy with the symptom described in DSM-4, DSM-5. Analogy with our components in our models. And this highlighted scales really showed significantly lower scores in depressed people in the speed of integration of actions. And generalized anxiety disorder studies, 165 patients and 200 normals. And as you see, the pattern is different. And look how important it is, again, to separate between physical and social verbal aspects. In physical aspects, there's no differences in anxious people, unless they do comorbid, they start being more depressed. And this would show you the differential power of the model. And if you go to comorbid, and that's a good sample we did when we compared three different diagnoses, depression, anxiety, and comorbid depression, anxiety, we received this pattern for comorbid conditions. Combined depression and anxiety condition. When we see that comorbid condition really, really damage cortical function, they are losing the context processing. They can't just comprehend what's happening around them. They become more impulsive, of course. Right? So all traits, including impulse control, are related to frontal lobe functioning. And when we compare them statistically, we actually saw statistical differences, and that's important, right? We saw statistical differences in the traits between anxious and depressed people, and between depressed people and people who have both comorbid depression and anxiety. So that's basically signature for the three diagnoses. And the summary is, see, we have several steps to integrate several sciences and derive maybe taxonomy based on the overlap between sciences. We suggest to go after consensus. We are not suggesting anything controversial, but we think that our model is applicable for both classification of mental disorders and mental illness. Thank you, my colleagues, and here are two pages of references.
Thank you very much for this impressive overview. Yes. Anecdotal observation we made in the late 90s, as you know, the serotonin 5-HT2A receptor is very abundant in brain, and the drug company developed a selective antagonist for that particular receptor. And we gave it to humans, and we could confirm by PET that we occupied virtually 100% of the 5-HT2A receptors. Mm-hmm. Then we gave a dose which was 8 times higher than the dose that already more or less blocked the receptors. Nothing reported, nothing observed, no pharmacodynamic effect whatsoever. So why do we have 5-HT2A receptors?
Yeah, it's cool, it's a cool one. That's why I say, you know, it's a lot of levels of control. Even people themselves can't identify any changes in their behavior. They might feel something came pretty weird, but they can go with their routines. And that's important, really, to separate aspects of behavior regulated when we consciously think in what we're doing, and aspects of behavior that we call automatic. And in fact, like, what, 90% of our behavior is automatic. So maybe this lack of any differences or reporting difference in patients because maybe they didn't need their brain. In the same way that some addicts, like alcoholic people, right, they can barely stand, but they can drive. like in Moscow, I'm sorry, I came from Russia, so they are really bragging that they barely could see anything, but they go and they sit down in the, you know, in the cars, and they drive home, and they're very proud that they made it, because they actually use not their brains that the receptors were occupied, okay, let them be occupied, but they used with low level of regulations that, you know, drove them.
There are many car accidents, right?
I thought this was a really interesting presentation. I think the critique you offer against the lexical approach was highly relevant and also very thought-provoking, I would say, because I think we have a tradition here at KI to be very influenced by the lexical factor analysis approach of arranging, well, as you say, language and descriptors. But as yourself, you pointed out, this approach, going from the temperament or the biological anchored approach, is messy. Really messy.
It's difficult.
It's very difficult. When we do future pet studies and we collect data on healthy controls of patients, and if we would administer it basically the SDQ, like what do you recommend that we do with that? Should we just correlate?
I would suggest doing with contrast groups. So what I would suggest, having a good size sample, and do the contrast groups. And that's easy. You just have 100 people with low motor endurance, for example, social endurance or high endurance, or low tempo, high tempo, low plasticity, high plasticity, and you go on. And if you have even better samples, then you can combine the traits. You can see the combinations of the traits. And I see that all endurance traits are down. This meaning already, serotonergic things. If only intellectual endurance is down, which is mental endurance, it's more like acetylcholine, so it's okay, no problem. And if all speed of integration traits are down, like the person is sluggish, motor-wise, and rigid, etc., I already suspect something with dopamine. And because I know how they regulate each other, I kind of know what to propose to use the systems which are still okay intact to kind of compensate and arrange our behavioral sort of adjustments instead of trying to fix the system that is broken.